Why is my shortwave loop antenna receiving signals in the 2-meter band it isn't actually designed for? Today, we are explaining the full picture for the whole frequency spectrum. In earlier videos, we took a deep dive into design and building electrical small loops for SDR reception. Although their shape isn't critical, we assumed it to be circular for analytical modeling. We tested 2-meter diameter, corresponding to a 6.28 meter circumference, which is delivering good reception up to a cutoff frequency of about 20 MHz. On my SDR receiver, both signal strength and noise floor are significantly better compared to a dipole. This makes long and shortwave listening fun. Surprisingly, in the 2-meter amateur radio band, the loop is showing good results. Based on our dimensioning, we didn't expect it to work at 145 MHz, which is well above its theoretical cutoff frequency. Apparently, there are still some secrets to uncover yet. First of all, we'd like to thank PCBWay, the sponsor of this video. They are offering great deals related to PCBs, 3D printing, CNC machining, sheet metal fabrication and injection molding. Furthermore, there is a community platform for us makers to share projects. And I also like their module offers. Just take a look at their websites. Take the easy way with PCBWay. Our computation model for dimensioning is based on the radiation impedance approximation for electrically small loops. Strictly speaking, it only applies as long as the circumference is much smaller than the wavelength, like a tenth or so. Nevertheless, reasonable accuracy is achieved computing the signal up to the cutoff frequency corresponding to half a wavelength. The orange curve is corresponding to our antenna mentioned before, simulated with a radio signal of 10 microvolts per meter in the air. Knowing the circumference C equals 6.28 meters, the model is valid above 12.56 meter wavelengths, respectively below a frequency of 23.88 MHz. However, we must be aware that at low frequencies we may only be scratching the surface and that beyond that rules can change completely. But we are determined to find out. Calculating the radiation impedance for the entire frequency range is complicated. But don't worry, I will just use the result. If you are interested, you can find further details in publications or in the book Antenna Analysis by E.A. Wolf. The graphs are showing the loop's radiation resistance and reactance as a function of the circumference C divided by the wavelength lambda. The omega parameter depends on the wire's thickness in relation to the loop's diameter. As the frequency increases, radiation impedance is becoming an extreme roller coaster ride, which I would be really afraid of. In the blue areas, we find resonances, and in the red ones, there are strange singularities where it's becoming very large. The reactance is close to zero at resonances. We will ignore it in the following. However, we don't forget it can reach large positive or negative values in between. 2 meter diameter and 1 millimeter wire thickness are resulting in omega equal to 18. For our mag loop design, we were only considering this frequency range. The radiation resistance is extremely low here, and the antenna's radiation pattern is similar to a magnetic dipole. While it's delivering sufficient signal strength for reception, you want to have an impedance matching for transmitting. This is achieved using a parallel capacitance making the loop resonant. Together with a weak inductive or capacitive coupling, some milliohms can be matched to 50 ohms. In that case, low ohmic loss, meaning thick materials, is crucial for good efficiency since the loop is actually loaded. In the non-resonant receive case, standard cables, for example 1 mm, are sufficient. Moving to higher frequencies, not only impedance is changing dramatically. Radiation patterns are splitting into multiple lobes. In previous videos, we examined it for different heights above ground. At resonances of 1, 2 and 3 times the loop's fundamental frequency, the radiation resistance is approximately 120 ohms. Not ideal, but suitable for a decent signal at a 50 ohms receiver's input. Using a 2-to-1 balloon, you can achieve a broadband impedance match. You can realize a narrowband matching using a 75 ohms coax quarter wave transformer, transforming 50 into 112 ohms. Here is a special own development, a lambda loop with an integrated matching network consisting of a line transformer and a capacitive coupling. It's an important insight. We need different matching networks for different operating modes of loops. Back to our 6.28 meters shortwave loop. We are now investigating a frequency range from 0 to 150 MHz. There is a resonance at 3 times the fundamental frequency, exactly at 145 MHz, explaining the good reception in the 2 meters band. Switching to a logarithmic frequency scale, we can compare the results to those presented in previous videos where we computed the signal at a 50 ohm receiver input. From 0 to 20 MHz, the orange curve is almost identical for both the complex and simple calculation model. Okay, that's no surprise, otherwise it wouldn't be a good approximation. At higher frequencies, however, we see a completely different behavior. The antenna is receiving higher frequencies, but instead of one cutoff, there are several notches in the extended range. On the dBm scale, the dips are up to 30 dB, corresponding to a factor of 1000. And the influence of the reactants we neglected further deepens the dips in reality. This effect can be used to filter out in the modulation interference, for example from broadcast services or mobile devices. It's particularly advantageous for SDR receivers, as they usually have low intermodulation immunity. We demonstrated this several times on the channel. Next, I'm simulating a preamp with 500 ohms instead of 50, and apparently the dips can be reduced. However, there are other aspects to consider when using a preamplifier, such as linearity, intrinsic noise, etc. I think we should do a separate video on preamps, as they can have both advantages and disadvantages. What do you think? Just comment me on that. Their properties are indeed more complicated than you think the first moment. While the small loops approximation is good for Mach loop design, it doesn't describe the behavior at higher frequencies. I hope our graphical explanations help you to understand the bigger picture, and I'm looking forward to your comments. We will certainly build and test more loops. Furthermore, we definitely need to explain impedance matching options. Now, stay tuned and don't forget to support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.